When I was in my early 20s, I went through something of a crisis of faith, where I really began to explore the question, what do I believe? Like, what do I really believe? And which is it's a powerful question, it's a profound question, it's a necessary question, because our beliefs shape our attitudes, it shapes our feelings, our beliefs shape our behaviors, they determine how we live. And to not believe something is a belief too. And so what we want to do is we want to step back and we want to ask the question, like, what do we believe, essentially when it comes to being in the movement of Jesus, being a follower of Jesus? And in this series, we want to bring it back to three symbols. We want to distill it down to three symbols that are at the core of our faith. We're going to talk about the cross, the cup, and the water. These three symbols of what it means to be a follower of Jesus. And I believe it's going to be a powerful series for all of us as we take it back down to the historical move of Jesus, what it means to be a follower. And you may just find that in these three symbols is the truth that you've been looking for, that you've been searching for all along. And today, we have an opportunity to kick off the series with our friend David Nasser. I've known David for a long time and followed his ministry, and I've been able to see up close that he loves Jesus. He's got a gift for being able to communicate the word and to be able to take these truths that are in the scripture and help us see them fresh and see them almost like for the very first time again. And so today we get to hear from David. He's going to talk about the symbol of the cross. And I'm excited for what God's going to speak into our lives through him. So I'd invite you to put your hands together and let's welcome David Nasser to Cross Point.
Good morning. Let's pray together. Can we do that? Father, we're grateful for moments like this, where we come into this room and we gather at the foot of the cross, even ground. Some of us singing about your faithfulness in one of the hardest weeks of our life. And some of us singing about your faithfulness in one of the most gratifying weeks of our life. In this very room, God, people probably found out that the cancer is back, and people found out that cancer is gone. In a church this side, God, with even people watching on live stream, people found out that they had a miscarriage, and people found out that they're finally going to get to have a baby. And so there's just been valleys and mountaintops represented here, and in all of that, we gather at the same foot of the cross saying you're faithful. You're good. You're good when it goes right, and you're good when it goes off the rails. We thank you, God, that we don't just get led from the stage. We get led by the guy sitting in front of us, the lady behind us. And we just all together are reminded that we are a community of believers on even ground, bowed down in need of a Savior at the foot of a cross. I pray that today, as we talk about the cross, even as Pastor Kevin said, a symbol that we're all familiar with, that you would renew our spirit towards what Jesus, you did. Rekindle our passion. Make us have childlike wonder again if we've lost it. For those who might not know you, who right now close their eyes and bow their heads and pray more to a black void than a Christ that they know intimately, come, Jesus, and reveal yourself. Glory revealed. Reveal yourself. Raise the dead. We pray this in your name. Amen. Such an honor to be at this great church, by the way. My wife and I just moved to Franklin, Tennessee, and we moved here from Lynchburg, Virginia, where last year, as a campus pastor at Liberty University, I had the privilege of having multiple leaders from this church at our convocation. Our convocation at Liberty was the largest weekly gathering of young adults in the world. It's about 13,000 students, that kind of 10 to 13,000 that gather twice a week. And Pastor Kevin Queen came and did for us a Wednesday morning and a Wednesday night. That's really really, really rare that we would give someone the gauntlet, we call it, the morning and the night. That night is a Bible study with about 7,000, 6,500 students that come to it. And I got to tell you, as soon as I heard him preach those two times, I became instantly connected to watching him on podcasts and joining you guys so many Sundays. You know, like I would go to my church and then I'd come home and I'd watch this church. And so I feel like I'm not a visitor in the sense that I've joined you before online. It's good to finally be here. Man, what a blessing to just sit under your teaching, Kevin. You're so deeply grounded in scripture. You're so committed. And then just the posture by which you bring God's word, your humility, brother. I hope you know what a gift he is. And then the worship team, wow, amazing today, just to be able to be led by them. You know you're going to have talent because it's Nashville, it's Music City, y'all, you know, but talent comes and goes, but anointing, there's polish and then there's power, and there's just power here in the way that this team leads, you know, and I hope you know the rarity that God has allowed you to be a part of in something like this. When I was at Liberty one time a few years ago, this student came in and wanted to meet with me, and he sits down and he goes, hey, this is kind of an awkward thing, but I need to tell you. He said, I have a question for you, and I wanted to ask in private because I didn't want anybody else to hear because it's kind of weird. He said, how do you get someone like your wife? And I go, what do you mean? He goes, well, you know, I'm not trying to be rude or anything, but like you're kind of like a 7, you know, and she's kind of like a 10, you know, like, and he goes, I'm saying 7, by the way, he says like 7, like generously, because I'm like a walking chia pet. Like, look, I'm from Iran, so we go through like puberty when I'm like not. When I take my shirt off, you're like, why is he wearing a North Face fleece in this stuff? Like, I'm. So it's just bad. Anyway, pray for my wife. Anyway, so he's like, dude, you're like a 7, and like she's like a 10, and then I've been around her. She's amazing, and you know you're awesome, but like she's amazing. He goes, and I gotta tell you, I'm like a 7. So like, how does a 7 get like a 10? And I didn't know whether to like kick him out of my office or give him a high five because it was true. And when he left, I asked, I called my wife and I said, hey, I just had the student ask me, how does a guy, you know, like get beyond what he deserves in you? And I had to have someone from the outside come and remind me that like, I don't deserve you. And I hope that you're not so pickled in like always being here and having this worship team to go, this is how it is in most churches. Most churches have like some dude out of key singing, I stand in awe of you while everyone's sitting down. So just so you know, you are blessed to be where you are. And so God gets all the glory. Can we just thank our worship team, our creative team, Pastor Kevin, his family. What a gift. Amen. God loves it, by the way, when we admonish one another. He's not threatened by his personality going, it's all me. You know, he knows when his children are edified and encouraged, and that's a good thing. But it's so awesome that I get to open up this series with you about these icons of our faith, these symbols that maybe are similar to anyone who grew up in church culture, especially in the buckle of the Bible Belt like Nashville, all right? But sometimes they're so similar that we quit looking up. Especially at a church called Crosspoint, where I get to preach on the cross at Crosspoint in feeling like I'm almost around a bunch of people who live at the airport or by the airport. You know like how people who like live by the airport don't hear the plane anymore? And maybe you're so a part of, you know, Crosspoint. You're so always around everything your pastor preaches, always being grounded in the good news of the cross, that we become sometimes too familiar with these icons. And a lot of times we just like hear about it and smell the aroma of it, but we just don't ever partake. And I'm hoping and I'm praying that today, maybe something that might be very familiar for a lot of people in the room, and maybe for the first time for some in the room, something that you're being approached, like presented to, is something that really makes you stop and think about not a historical event that happened 1,988 years ago, where Jesus Christ died on a cross for the sins of mankind. Not that you would hear this and think about it as a historical event, but that you would take it very personally. And that if anything, here's the word, that it would feel like the hour you first believed. Now, when I say the gospel, when I say the cross, when I say salvation, when I say these words that are iconic words of our faith, I don't know what comes to your mind, but just so that it has been said, proclaimed, you know, from this stage with a microphone, the gospel, which means the good news, is basically this, that man exists. You exist. I exist. but that we exist, every single one of us, exist as sinners in need of a Savior. Now, when I say that, if you're like the note-taking kind and you got to write something down because that's why you brought your journal, point number one would be that you exist. And you're like, okay, that's so kiddie pool. Like, I mean, are we going to go deeper than that? I know I exist. But let's just stop right here and establish that you exist as a sinner. No one's got to teach you how to sin growing up. I have a granddaughter. Her name is Avery. She's precious. And we dress her up really cute with all these outfits my wife keeps buying from Target, you know. And she looks perfect. She looks precious. But let me just tell you something. She's a little me monster. She's a baby and she is a little sinner. All right, no one's got to teach her how to sin. No one's got to teach her, like, don't throw a tantrum. You know, this is how you throw a tantrum. This is how you lie. You know, she will learn on her own how to, like, say no, even though it should be a yes. Not, you know, like, she will learn. No one's, in her is this Adamic nature. She's a professional little sinner. My sister has she named her first child Emmanuel. I mean, when you name a child, you know, God with us, Emmanuel. And she, my sister's just about Amish, y'all. Like, she protects her children. Like, they don't watch Netflix. So she just chlorinates the pool to the point where it's like burning your eye. I mean, she's so conservative. And her child, Emmanuel, was homeschooled little kid. He would wear like linen outfits. And at the end of the day, they wouldn't be wrinkled, that kid. All right. You know, and so I remember one time when he was 2 years old, we're in the car and we drove and we stopped at a gas station. And she had told me, she said, hey, I know he's spending the half day with you, but do not give him chocolate because he's weaning himself off of chocolate. I'm like, ain't no kid weaning themselves off of chocolate. Anyway, so I went and got M&Ms because she's not the boss of me, all right? You know, and I was just trying to make sure he didn't get beat up every day after school later, you know? So give him an immune system or something. Anyway, so we get in the car and I gave him some M&Ms. And an hour later, he had like an M&M mustache. He was just sugared up. And I gave him over to my sister. And my sister looked right at him. I mean, there was literally chocolate like right here in the corner. And she looked at him and she goes, Emmanuel, have you been eating chocolate? And he looked right at her and he goes, mm-mm. He's a little liar. No one had to teach him how to lie. I helped, but that's beside the point. So every one of us, and it rears its ugly head, right? Like the seeds of sin and everything in us, and what, like, this depends on what gets watered in the plant house that we are, right? Rears their ugly head. So every single one of us is a sinner. A sinner. And so can we all agree that we've all fallen short and that every single one of us, one out of one of us, fails God miserably? And so you might have not committed adultery in person, but you've committed it in your heart. You might have not committed murder, but maybe you murdered someone's reputation in this thing called prayer requests, but it was really gossip. And we're all sinners. And so, point number one, we exist. You're real. And you're real, a real sinner. And so we're all sinners. And guess what? Point number two, God exists. And so we're real and God is real. You gotta give God this reality, right? Like, you might go, well, I don't know. I mean, I don't know. I think we came from a bang. Well, who created the bang, right? If you think we come from a bang and you go take it all the way down to an atom, and I'm not a brainy person. I'm sorry, there's somebody from Vandy here right now already judging me, going, you'll never get into Vandy. I know. All right, but I also want to throw that in. Where you at, Vandy people? You don't win football games, but it's okay. Yeah. But and she's like, that's so cute. Football's so cute. I know. Anyway, so... I don't know, this, ma'am, you can teach me later for the 5 o'clock service. All right, but here's the thing. Like, the bang, they say, came from an atom, but then, like, break the atom. Who created the atom? The nucleus. What's in the nucleus? Like, Bandy, the nu. What's in the nu? The n. What's in the n? The e is somewhere down there. That felt so academic, what I just said. That felt kind of like Lipscomb more than Bandy. Anyway, but somewhere in there, there has to be, like, even if it all started with a, who started the, there has to be a creator. And so, I know this sounds so simple, but we exist as sinners, and God exists, the creator that created all. In the beginning was the Word. In the beginning, before there was a beginning, there was a beginner who began the beginning. Someone had to begin the beginning. In the beginning, that beginner, that God who exists, existed as a holy God, and he's never moved off of that. And so we exist, God exists. We are sinners. God is sinless. And that separates us from God. Matter of fact, that word holiness literally means to be set apart. And so we got a problem. The problem is that we exist and we are sinners, and God exists and God is sinless, and our sin separates us from God. And God can't just, being a just God, let bygones be bygones and remove that sin without anything. He can't just be like, I'm okay with that. I'll just pretend like it didn't happen. If God pretended like sin wasn't happening, that wouldn't make God God. That would make God us. We're good at pretending like sin ain't happening. But God's standard is very different than you and I. And we grade on a curve, right? We grade on a curve. We look at what's happening with, like, you know, Osama bin Laden, and we go, I've never done that. And yes, yes, in the economy of this world, you've never done that. But in the economy of God, God grades on a very different, his standard is perfection. And so none of us are bad in a thousand, to say the least. And so God exists and we exist. We're sinners, God is sinless, and our sin is there. And God can't just let bygones be bygones and just pretend like it's not there. That penalty, that sin, that separation exists. And so God sends his son, God the Father sends God the Son to come down. And 1,988 years ago, Jesus comes down, lives a perfect, sinless life. And after having lived a sinless, pure, perfect life, he dies on a cross, a sinner's death. And the weight of the sins of this world get put on him. So that in the courtroom of life, when God says, I exist, yes, God, you do. You exist, yes, God, I do. You're a sinner, yes, God, I am. How do you plead? I go, I plead 100% guilty, but I plead 100% Christ. He covers it. He paid the debt I could not pay. And so God says, I'm going to send my son to be the way, the truth, and the life. And so your sin brings you death, but I bring my son because I can't let bygones to be bygones. Someone has to pay the penalty for the sin, and my son becomes the sacrificial lamb. Now, the question isn't, is that revolutionary new truth for everybody in this room? I'm going to guess you picked Crosspoint as your church, so you've probably heard about the cross before. Your pastor puts the cross in everything. He could be doing a three-week series on spending, finances, and it's about the cross. It could be about dating. It's about the cross because he understands, like, at the end of the day, he can clean up all your spending and make you cut up your credit cards, David, you know, Rainey style. He can do all that stuff, right? But at the end of the day, it's just behavior modification until you realize I belong to God and so does my wallet. And because of the cross, the way I spend has to honor the cross. If it's about dating, then all of a sudden he's like, hey, you're just not single. You're never really, really single if you're single. You really belong to God. You're eternally actually in this great marriage. And guess what? You're actually the bride of Christ, and this is the beauty of the gospel. And so he always tethers everything to the gospel because the gospel is the very hope that we have in every friendship we have, in every parenting decision we make, in every spending decision we make, in every single facet of who we are in between Sundays. And the question isn't, have you heard the gospel? Do you know about the gospel? The question is, do you love the gospel? Not even have you gone through the gospel, but like, is it in the rearview mirror? Or do you every single day preach to yourself the gospel? That he who knew no sin became sin so that we could become the righteousness of God. That's an incredible passage out of scripture. That Jesus who knew no sin became sin. The sins of the weight of the world became on him, got on him. Think about that. I mean, it's hard to think about it, but and to really put our mind fully around it, but I'll just try for just a second. Like, you, sir, in the front row, look like you probably sin a whole lot less than me. I'm just gonna guess, all right? You're just a really good guy. But you're not pretending that you're perfect, right? Right. And so think about your sin, and then think about the person sitting beside you. Do you know them? Do you know this person really well? I'm sorry? She's a 10, yeah. Nice, good answer. But you and I both know she's a sinner too, right? So think about all the sins that you've committed this week and then all the sins that she's committed but didn't show you because she thinks I'm a 10. You know, so think about all the sins you've committed, and then think about the person beside you and the person around you and the person. This one room has like 800 people in it in this one particular service, and then everybody watching live. So think about all the sins you've committed and all the sins this person, but not just the sins you've committed. What's your name? Can I just ask?
Nick,
not just the sins you've committed this week, but all the sins you've ever committed. But not just the sins you've ever committed, Nick. Think about every sin you've ever committed, Nick, and think about every sin you're ever going to commit. You don't know all the sins you're going to commit. Some of y'all are like, oh, yes, I do. This afternoon, I'm going home, and I'm planning on keeping on. Okay, but you don't know like 3 years from now sin. You don't know. So think about every sin you've ever committed, Nick, every sin you're ever going to commit, every sin she's ever committed, every sin she's ever going to commit, and then the people around you, and not just at the, 11 o'clock service, but all the sins accumulated of every single person at the 9 o'clock service, and then the 5:30 service, and not just this campus, but all the campuses, and not just these campuses, but all the churches that'll gather, and all the people who don't come to church in Nashville, and then just beyond Nashville, think about every sin that's ever been committed, and every sin that'll ever be committed in Tennessee. And then beyond that, the United States of America, and then beyond that, North America, and then beyond that, the world. So think about every sin that has ever been committed in the world and every sin that will ever be committed in the world. He who knew no sin took on all of that sin. I don't know about you, Nick, but my sin is plenty to trouble him. Much less taking all of that on. So it's one thing if you're kind of rich and you go, I can pick up the debt of somebody. It's another thing if somebody goes, oh, I heard you can pick up the debt. Can you pick up mine and mine and mine and mine and mine and mine and the accumulative measurement of every sin that's ever been committed? He who knew no sin became sin so that we could become the righteousness of God. If that doesn't bring you to a place of gratitude, then whatever will. Anybody here see the movie Saving Private Ryan by chance before anybody see it? Cool, it's rated R. But I've seen it too. And I actually love that movie. It's one of my favorite movies. And I remember the day it came out. I was so anticipating it coming out because it had Tom Hanks and it was by Steven Spielberg. So I was like, this is going to be like beyond double threat. This is going to be like triple threat. And I remember going to see this movie and I went at like noon, like the first early showing, because I was so waiting for it. I took the day off, and I went. And I remember I bought the 50-gallon drum of popcorn you buy, because it's only like 10 cents more to go XL, with the WD-40 on it. Like you mortgage your house to get that drum of Coke. So I get the whole thing. I go in, I sit down. I'm the only one in the theater, y'all. And these two elderly gentlemen come in the theater. And out of all these seats, they sit right in front of me. And the movie previews start. Then they get done, and the movie begins. Now, if you've never seen this movie, it is a fictional narrative attached to an actual historical story. So it's a fictional story attached around the Battle of D-Day and this world war that we had, where basically Allied forces in 1944 got together, right, to fight against Hitler and fight the Holocaust that took the innocent life of 6 million people. And so the very first scene of this movie, they call it the most realistic war scene in cinematic history. Is literally a 5-minute reenactment, right, of the Battle of D-Day at Omaha Beach. And I remember the movie starts, and the first thing they do is they kind of give you a flyby of Omaha Beach. It is what you think it'll be. It's this beautiful beach in France. It seems romantic and serene and restful, but then the camera brings you right into this water vessel. It's like a cargo ship, a small one, and these soldiers are in there. I say soldiers loosely. Some of them look like kids, like boys. This one guy, his hand is shaking because he knows any second now this water vessel is going to open up. And when it opens up, they're being asked to jump out of this water vessel onto this beach with the Nazis having high ground, just ready to just basically just spray them down. And this kid's hand is just shaking. He actually has to sit on his hand to stop it from shaking. The wave is going up and down and all this stuff. And they show this man. He pulls out a picture, looks at it like this is my little baby I haven't seen. And he kisses the baby and puts it there. And Spielberg does just such a good job of just painting the narrative of these soldiers that know. Any second now, I've got to go wage war. And then the latch opens up. And for the next 2.5 minutes, in THX surround sound, it's coming. And blood is being splattered. And you hear bullets in the water hitting people. And you see just arms falling off. And it is gory. And they say it's realistic, but you're sitting in the comfort of a theater watching that. And I remember I'm sitting there and I'm just watching this and I'm realizing this is not a popcorn kind of movie, and I'm putting it down. As I'm watching about 1.5, 2 minutes into this war scene, all of a sudden one of these elderly gentlemen that was sitting right in front of me, because it was so loud, yells to his friend in the middle of this like loud bombing moment. He goes, "This is just like when we were there." When I heard him say that, my eyes left the screen and I looked down at the guy that had just yelled that. And from behind, y'all, I could see his shoulder was just shaking. He was just weeping. And I've seen that movie a couple times since then. But that day, the first time, I never watched that movie from that moment on. I basically watched two men watch a movie and cry the entire movie. They just wouldn't stop crying. When the movie was over, I leave and I'm walking out and I just stopped at the hallway and I just stood there and I was just so shaken, so taken back. And I waited. And after a couple minutes, these elderly men, they came out. And I didn't mean to startle them, but I did. I just said, "Excuse me." And they looked up and I said, "I'm so sorry. I didn't mean to startle you." I said, "We were the only three in the theater and you guys were sitting right by me." And in the very beginning of the movie, I said, "Sir, I'm sorry, I don't mean to pry, but you yelled really loud, 'This is just like when we were there.' Can I just ask you, sir, were you there? Were you at Omaha Beach? Did you fight the Battle of D-Day?" And they just started weeping. These men just started crying again. Right there in the hallway, we're just standing outside of this theater. These men just start crying. He never said the word yes. He just shook his head. And his friend started crying, and he looked at me and he goes, "He lost his older brother that day too." And I realized two brothers were on that beach and one made it home and one didn't. And they hold hands. They're standing in this hallway and they just hold hands and they're just crying. And I didn't know them, but I just wanted to kind of like say, "Can I grab a hand?" But I didn't grab that. I just stood there and they were just crying and I just start crying. And the three of us are just standing there just crying. People are like leaving. How Stellar got her groove back, walking through going, "What's going on?" You know, we're just standing there. And I finally found a little wedge. Like they kind of came up for air for just a second. And I said, "Hey, before we walk any further, I'm about to leave y'all alone. But I just want to say thank you. I just put my hand out. I said, I just want to shake your hand, sir. I want to shake your hand. I know you gave a lot that day. I know it cost you your brother. I know it cost you a lot. It was very courageous. Thank you. I just want to say thank you." And they just shook my hand and we were all just standing there and it was a long handshake. And I walked out of there and I felt so patriotic. I walked out of there and I was just like, and I'm so proud. I felt like a Lee Greenwood CD on crack, y'all. I was like, and I'm proud to be a half American. That's just what I am. I'm an American by paperwork. I was a refugee from Iran. You know, when I was 18 years old, I got sworn in to become an American and I got beyond my green card. And so yeah, I'm an American by paperwork. Anybody here born in America? I wasn't born in America, but I felt like it didn't matter, like adopted in or naturalized. I mean, I walked into my car and I was just like, oh, I just feel so much gratitude. I just feel so much ownership. And the truth of the matter is, I wasn't surprised by the movie. I wasn't like, no one's ever told me about this Battle of D-Day. How come no one's ever brought this up? I remember when I was a junior in high school, I think we had a test on the war, and I think like there was a Scantron and a number two pencil, and I think I took it just enough like to get by, and I think I remembered it as a historical narrative, but that day, for about 2 hours, it was right in front of me, and it was personal. And he went from a historical event to something that was very much this reality that what happened in 1944 was someone put themselves in harm's way so that I would not be harmed. Someone stepped in and waged a bloody, violent act of selflessness so that I could have the freedom that I have as an American citizen. Does that make sense? And it's not about nationalism if you're one of those going, this is way too much about it. It's not. I think America makes a great country, a horrible God. Trust me when I say that, all right? And I'm not always going to be an American. One day I'll stop living, but I'm always going to be a citizen in the kingdom of God, all right? But I'm just telling you, that doesn't rob me from the reality that as an American, I watched what these men did. They stood in the gap for kids in Germany and other kids who just were born Jewish, and someone wanted them dead just because of that. And it just stirred up gratitude. And I say that to say, forget the Battle of D-Day. 2,000 years ago, on a hill called Calvary, Jesus Christ didn't hit the beach. He went on a cross, and sinless, powerful, could have bailed out Jesus, took the weight of the sins of the world. They put 9-inch nails through his body. He fought the good fight. And it was a bloody mess. He fought the good fight. And they put a crown of thorns on him, not because they wanted to call him king, but they wanted to ridicule him. And they pulled him down. This crown of thorns, they pulled it down. And you know, we see Easter cantatas. And when we see Easter cantatas, you know, there's usually a Jesus and he's really, really high. And the other two thieves on the cross, you know, and everything is just like lower. But in the reality was, it was always at ground level so that people could walk by and grab the crown of thorns and push it down and slap his face. And I know in the Easter cantata, we always put a loin around our Jesus because that's how we have to do it at Easter cantata. But in reality, Jesus was fully naked on the beach and he had carried his own weapon of mass destruction, the cross, and they'd beat him with a cat of nine tails, and everything that had happened had happened. They say that when they pierced his side, both blood and water came out. Most doctors that have studied the cross tell you it's because the human heart is surrounded by a water cavity that protects it, and Christ's heart was beating so fast, he was in so much physical pain, that it literally burst the water cavity, and that's why when they pierced his side, blood and water came out. And so I know you know about the cross here at Cross Point, but have you ever stopped to say thank you? How can I not say thank you with my dating relationship? How can I not say thank you with my friendship? How can I not say thank you with my being a dad, with my being a mom? How can I not say thank you in the way I spend my money, the way I think about things? How can my life be one great, I can never pay you back, but you stood in harm's way? You took the weight of the sins of this world and you didn't back down. We hear the word grace all the time, and the word grace is always in this fancy font with flowers around it. But oh, the violent grace of the cross. Unmerited favor. The worst exchange rate ever. That I would get what Jesus deserves, and Jesus would get what I deserve. That what I had coming to me, Jesus stood in the gap and said, I'll fight for you, you can't. So I know you know the cross. Maybe you don't. But if you do know the cross, never let it be in the rear view. Never get too numb to it. We can never pay him back, but we can honor. That's what I did that day in that hallway, right? I just looked at two men I honored them. We can honor the one who sacrificed more than anyone ever in history, Jesus Christ. With every aspect of everything we are. Now, if you don't know him, you're probably the one with the valid excuse in here. You're saying, when I'm hearing this for the first time, this account of the cross, I didn't know. If this is you, you didn't know. That's how valuable you are to God, that God would do that. By the way, in that illustration, if you don't know the Lord, you're actually the enemy. And Jesus actually doesn't see you as the enemy, even though you're the enemy. He sees you as the prize. He dies for the very one who bruised him. Me. What a survey of a wondrous cross. And so just wherever we are, can we just bow our heads just for a second? And listen, if today you're hearing this maybe for the first time or for the first time for real, and all of a sudden it's not just this historical event 1,988 years ago, it is a real event before you, and you're saying, I think I have spat at the face of Christ, and today I want to kiss the cheek. I think I've taken my hand and my lifestyle, and I've actually pulled down on the crown of thorns and mocked him as king and said, you're not the king of me. But today I want to bow at the foot of the cross instead and say, forgive me. I honor you. If you've never done that, maybe this is the moment. This is your D-Day. This is the moment when God fights the good fight in a way that you receive it. And I would say, ask Christ to step out of heaven, step into your life, to be your everything. Not just your heart. That's the front foyer. That's where he comes in, but to be your everything. But I would guess for a lot of us here today, you're going, David, I know the gospel. I was 11 years old. Somebody flannel graphed the gospel for me at VBS. I got saved. My godly grandmother shared it with me. I have a legacy of faith. I know, but today, don't ever lose your childlike wonder of the cross before me, the hope of glory. So, Lord, we thank you. We thank you, God, for the cross. We stand in the hallway and say, we're reminded today of what you did. And because of the cross, the way I'm going to treat my next door neighbor who doesn't treat me good is good. Because of the cross, the decisions that I've been making that are dishonoring today will switch to decisions that are going to be more honoring. Not to pay you back, not to earn your favor, but because I was just given it undeservingly. Thank you for the cross. If you've never given your life to Christ, here in just a little while, you're going to have an opportunity to maybe come to one of the prayer leaders in any of our campuses and say, man, I prayed that prayer for the first time a second ago, where I'm still confused. I want to talk some more. And there'd be something amazing in this moment if you said, I don't want to just hear about it. I actually want to make sure I'm giving my life over to him. My wife was that way, you guys. My wife grew up in the church, a really, really good church girl. She was on the pastor search committee when she was 16. She was Bible drill champion in the state of Alabama. She was just this really, really good girl. She was 18 years old when she went from religion to redemption. Because Christianity is not about you coming to the cross and going, I'm good. It's about you coming to the cross and going, I'll never be good enough. It's not about doing, but trusting. And I just wonder if today there's somebody here who's going, man, I think I've given him everything but my life. I'm giving him my money, my time, my efforts, my volunteering. I've just never given him my life. And maybe today God's saying, come home. Thank you begins with, like, I need you. So I don't know where you are in this, but I think there's something in it for all of us. So just for a second, all of our campuses are going to do this collectively together. Normally, everybody watches a video if you're not in this particular Nashville campus, and then our worship teams do their individual. But today, we want to, all over in Hendersonville and Franklin and all over, we want to sing at the same time, the same words of gratitude to God, all in one choir of gratitude. And so just, if you would, just bow your head for a second and go back to the hour you first believed, if you know him already. Think about what he's been. All my life, God, you've been faithful. All my life, God, you've been so good. And just as God begins to just bring you into that reality, I want to give you a chance as you prepare, just when you're ready, as you begin to come ready, we're going to just sing a few songs of survey and casting our heart on him and what he did. As you get ready, just stand as God begins to prepare your heart to go, David, can we just begin to just sing to him and love on him for the love that he lavished on us? And just as you just begin to prepare, just whenever God prepares your heart to just sing, you just begin to stand up. You might want to bend the knee. Just sit still. Or just stand and put your hand up in a posture of surrender.